so we'll then continue with things. We'll talk about solar energy. Did we start with solar energy? Last part. Yeah. So we'll continue with then steps taken by government to promote solar energy. The steps that have been taken by government to promote solar energy. First is, government has allowed accelerated depreciation to solar energy producers. Government has allowed accelerated depreciation to solar energy producers. Accelerated depreciation means that you are allowed to charge higher level of depreciation on your machines. So that allows the firms to replace their machines faster. Alright, accelerated depreciation, I can believe we recall depreciation. So accelerated depreciation is, the government allows these firms to charge higher level of depreciation than usually allowed, so that they can replace their machines more quickly. Now solar energy sector, production sector, is a sector with very high technological turnover. Technology changes very fast. So government, in order to facilitate this faster change in technology for producers, allows accelerated depreciation, that you can provision higher amount for your technology change or for your capital change, and that allows the producers two benefits. One, that they can then provision higher for replacement of capital and change it more easily. Two, it gives them tax benefit. In Indian tax laws, depreciation can be subtracted from your taxable income. So the larger is your depreciation charge, more you can subtract away. That is the idea. Alright. Then second thing that the government has done, you like to up to 30% benefit is provisioned for all commercial enterprise which have 100% solar energy dependency. All commercial enterprise which have 100% solar energy dependency. This is for rooftop harvesting. That if an enterprise shows that they are using rooftop harvesting or field harvesting and they are 100% dependent on solar energy alone, then they will get 30% tax benefit on it. Okay. Then you write third, encouraging production of solar panels by including it under Make in India program. So that makes easier availability of solar panels, and that results in faster production of solar energy. Then you write next. Government has allowed mega solar parks with capacity of up to 40,000 megawatt. Mega solar parks with capacity of up to 40,000 megawatt. And this mega solar park, see, up to 40,000 megawatt has been done from last year. The real benefit is large scale production of solar energy there. That then firms can increase their capacity to produce solar energy up to 40,000 megawatt. They will not need any further permission. Like generally the firms begin with 2,000 megawatt, 1,000 megawatt, 5,000 megawatt. Government says you can increase your capacity and take it up to 40,000 megawatt and no further permissions would be required. And then one more you write. India has been the founder member of International Solar Alliance India has been the founder member of International Solar Alliance. Now see, International Solar Alliance is a group of 121 countries. It is based on countries between tropics, partially or wholly. If a country is partially or wholly between tropics, then it is part of International Solar Alliance, or it is allowed into that. So India and France were the main players in COP21, that was in the Paris Accord, where this was created. The important thing about ISA is, International Solar Alliance is, it is the first treaty-based institution whose headquarter is in India. It's the first time this has happened. It's the first treaty-based institution whose headquarter is in India. It's in Gurugram, the headquarter. So first treaty-based institution with headquarters in India. Gurugram is the headquarter for this. And the recent meet happened. This year we had the first meet of ISA, International Solar Alliance. Three major decisions have been taken. In the first meeting of International Solar Alliance, three major decisions have been taken. One is scaling up solar energy for agricultural use. That is the first decision. Scaling up, like using on a larger scale. So scaling up solar energy for agricultural use. Second is scaling up solar energy research and development. Scaling up solar energy research and development. And third is spreading solar energy to less developed countries. Spreading solar energy to less developed countries. So these three things have been done: scaling it up for agriculture, scaling it up research and development, and spreading it to less developed countries. But see, with all this, we have two challenges in solar energy sector. One challenge is availability of land. That is one challenge, because solar panels are spread horizontally, and with the horizontal spread, a lot of land area gets covered, and land area becomes or is already a challenge in Indian context. So that is the first challenge we have in solar energy sector: availability of land. How do we create more and more land to get this? So that is why rooftop harvesting and all become more relevant. And the second challenge is bankruptcy of the firms. Firms, in their eagerness to get the contract, sometimes overcommit themselves. Like, we can supply energy to you at 3 rupees per kWh or 2 rupees per kWh. Then the market doesn't evolve like that. And when the market doesn't pay them that money, it means that the firms go bankrupt. So that is the second challenge, bankruptcy of the firms. I'll tell you why and how we can solve this. For horizontal spread of solar panels, one solution, possible solution, we have not yet got the commercial result, but one possible solution can be solar tree experiment, like creating solar panels in a vertical frame and then tapping energy from that. So solar tree experiment, TREE, solar tree experiment can be one solution to this challenge. And to the second aspect, bankruptcy of solar firms, what you should conclude saying is that the focus of the government should be not only on cheaper solar energy, but sustainable solar energy project. The firms should not only be focusing on how less price they can charge, it should also be focused on whether it can be sustainable, how consistent they can supply. All right, so that should be your conclusion, that the focal area in solar energy production should not only be reduction in cost of production, but also sustainability in production. Even if we pay a little more, that's completely fine, because that will be for benefit of our long-term purposes. So that should be our concluding time on that. Now, if we generalize all this discussion over the electricity sector, see, we produce 3,30,000 megawatt, approximately, I'm telling you, this is 31st March 2018. I'm using economic survey as the reference point. So 3,30,000 megawatt is our capacity, out of which around 22% now is by renewable sources. But there are, like, around 70,000 megawatt is through renewable sources. But there are two different but major challenges that our electricity sector faces. So when we talk about challenges of electricity sector, power sector, that is, First is failure of generation companies . I'm sure you are reading it in newspapers that we have 170,000 crore of NPAs that the generation companies have accumulated. So we have had failures of generation companies, that our power generation companies have not been able to succeed as much as what we would have liked them to be. There are two reasons for this. Reasons are, one, very low plant load factor. This is one reason within it. A, very low plant load factor. Plant load factor is capacity utilization. How much capacity do you use of your firm? Like, suppose if I have created a generation company of 100,000 megawatt, and if my plant load factor is 40%, then I'm using 40,000 megawatt is what I'm able to produce. So very low plant load factor. In fact, the plant load factor is now 52% for private companies and 68% for public sector. Ideally, the plant load factor should be 85% to 88%. Ideally, plant load factor should be 85% to 88%, but that has come down to 50%, 52% for private sector companies and 65%, 67%, 68% for the public sector companies. What is the problem with this, imagine? The problem is, if you have low plant load factor, that is low capacity utilization, then you cannot earn enough revenue to pay for your capital cost, technological upgradation, and so on. You know, so that is the problem of low plant load factor. All right, so this is problem that we have. Very low plant load factor, capacity utilization. This is due to two reasons. This low plant load factor is due to two reasons. One is low availability of coal. That is one. This low plant load factor, first factor is low availability of coal. So, and not only low availability, inconsistent availability. They get coal not at the right time, and that results in not being able to utilize the existing units better. So that is one problem. The second problem they have is outdated technology. Many of these plants are now 30 years old, 35 years old. So the technology has become outdated. They are not able to utilize all their plant entirely because of poor technical component. So this is your problem one of very low plant load factor. The second problem is low level of recovery of dues. This is from the GenCops, all right, or DISCOMs. Low level of revenue generation. This is the problem we have. The second problem we have in it is low level of revenue generation. The money earned by these companies is very low. And this money earned is low mainly because distribution companies are not placing orders to buy from them. See, as a GenCom, I create capacity of 330,000 megawatt. But if people are not willing to buy from me, you know, that is my DISCOMs, then where do I sell this capacity? And even when they buy from me, they keep defaulting on the dues that they have to pay to me. You know, that makes things worse. So this is where GenComs are struggling economically. That orders are not being placed, and then it becomes more amusing when then the power minister says that India is an energy surplus country. We are producing more than what we are demanding. Well, we are demanding less, no doubt about it, but we are demanding less because of negative issues rather than because we have produced much more and now nobody in India needs electricity. So, you know, this is where we confuse things at times. So when you talk about low revenue generation, this is connected to the second issue that our power sector faces, this low revenue generation. That second issue is failure of DISCOMs. Distribution companies. Failure of DISCOMs. distribution companies, DISCOMs, DISCOMs have seen a lot of bankruptcy in the last 5-7 years, especially last 7-8 years, especially between 2010 to 13, and this continues. So the major reason why DISCOMs are failing is because of very high transmission and distribution losses. Average tariff and commercial losses is also what it is called, ATC. All right, but this is actually, so this is due to high transmission and distribution or average tariff commercial losses. All right, transmission and distribution loss is a nice euphemism we have created to replace stealing of electricity. Actually, there is a lot of electricity theft in our country. People don't pay the bill. We have given it a name, transmission and distribution loss. All right, so it looks nice when spoken in English, but actually it is for the theft of electricity. People don't pay the bill, and even if they are billed, they don't pay. Sometimes they are not even billed. You know, that is the problem. And that creates overburden on the DISCOMs, and then failure of power supply and so on. And that has a lot to do with the populist policies of the political parties. When during election campaigns it is announced that we will give you power free, and then, you know, the DISCOMs have to bear the burden. Now, I'll tell you how big, I hope you understand the issue there. And this means the DISCOMs are not able to generate their revenue. And if they are unable to generate their revenue, they will not be able to place further orders, do their own maintenance. Another problem that DISCOMs face is overstaffing. Again, because of political interference in DISCOMs, overstaffing is an issue. Much more people, in fact, in 2015, CSO had presented a report saying that that overstaffing in DISCOMs in India is in the ratio 2.5:1. That is, for one place that needed, 2.5 people are working. So, you know, it's like 15 people working where 6 were needed. This again creates losses for the DISCOMs because you have to pay your wage bill at a high rate and so on. Now, this became a huge issue. This is still a huge issue. This became a huge issue in November 2015. It was estimated that total accumulated losses of DISCOMs was 3,14,000 crore. This was November 2015. It was estimated that the total accumulated losses of DISCOMs had reached 3,14,000 crore. And then most of these losses were turning into NPAs. They were not paying the money back to the banks. So government introduced a program which is called Ujjwal DISCOM Assurance Yojana, their scheme. Ujjwal DISCOM Assurance Yojana. This Ujjwal DISCOM Assurance Yojana has been introduced from November 2015 for improving operational, managerial, I'm telling you the objective of Uday, for improving operational, managerial and financial efficiency, operational, managerial and financial efficiency of DISCOMs. I repeat again, Ujjwal DISCOM Assurance Yojana was introduced from November 2015 for improving operational, managerial and financial efficiency of DISCOMs. That was the purpose. Now see, the scheme was or is a very good plan. I'll tell you why one says that. In this Uday scheme, what was done was, or what is done is, that the state governments will take over the loans of the DISCOM. You take it down, right? Under Uday, state governments will take over 75% of the loans of DISCOMs. And these loans again will not be taken over on free basis. This will be taken over with state governments now taking share in the DISCOMs. They will take the equity in the DISCOMs. Alright. So but 75% of the loans of DISCOMs and issue bonds and issue bonds to pay back these loans. To pay back these loans. So see what is happening. The state government will take over the loan of the DISCOM, issue bonds to people, financial institutions, banks, to pay back these loans back to the banks from where it was taken. Now what was between DISCOMs and banks, the loan I mean, is shifted to between state government and people. So that means banks' balance sheet get cleared. Now banks don't have any NPA, and DISCOM's balance sheet get cleared. They don't have 75% of their loans. This is to solve the twin balance sheet deficit. I'm believing that Shyam sir must have taught you NPAs and all that. So to solve the twin balance sheet deficit, this thing works out. All right, that this will help in DISCOMs now going for new loans, and banks free to give these loans, and DISCOMs can then modernize themselves, work for better recovery and so on. This was the basic idea. You write in the same thing, DISCOMs are allowed to issue bonds. DISCOMs are allowed to issue bonds for rest 25% of loans. But the thing is, why would the state governments join it? And what will be their interest? So state governments have been incentivized by different benefits. So you write incentive for the state government. Incentive for the state government. First, cheaper coal to state generation companies. To state generation companies. Generation companies are those which produce electricity. So for state generation companies, cheaper coal will be given by Coal India Limited. Cheaper coal to state generation companies by Coal India Limited. So states have been said, we will give you cheaper coal if you join UDAY as a program. Second, cheaper electricity to state government. So you know, to meet programs like Deen Dayal Upadhyay Gram Jyoti Yojana, where you have to electrify your rural areas and all. So cheaper electricity to state government for programs like DDU-GJY. DDU-GJY is Deen Dayal Upadhyay Gram Jyoti Yojana. Deen Dayal Upadhyay Gram Jyoti Yojana. So cheaper electricity to state government for programs like Deen Dayal Upadhyay Gram Jyoti Yojana from NTPC. And another one is that not counting the loans taken over by state government, not counting the loans taken over by state government under fiscal deficit of the state, not counting the loans taken over by state government under fiscal deficit of the state for the first 2 years, not counting the loans taken over by state government under fiscal deficit of the state for the first 2 years. So this is to tell the state that your fiscal deficit record will not be blemished. We will not be counting it as a part of the state government values. This is how, you know, they have incentivized the states. 27 states out of 29 have joined UDAY scheme. West Bengal and Orissa are the only two states which have not joined it. All right, 27 states out of 29 have joined UDAY scheme. West Bengal and Orissa are the only two states which have not joined it. Orissa has not joined it because they don't need it. The DISCOM is doing well. West Bengal has not joined it because of political differences. We all know how much Trinamool Congress and BJP get along. You know, so that means they are not joining it. So West Bengal, for political differences, their DISCOMs are in a poor shape. But they didn't like UDAY, they didn't go for it. And Orissa, because their DISCOMs are okay, they are doing fine. So this is what, and now see, what are the benefits of UDAY? There are three major benefits that UDAY promises. One is, it reduces interest cost for the DISCOMs. As the UDAY scheme gets implemented, interest cost for DISCOMs come down. Why? Because if I take over 75% of your loan, then certainly I take over 75% of your interest. All right. So if I had to pay 10 rupees interest, now I'll have to pay 2.5 rupees because my loan has been taken over by somebody else. So interest cost of DISCOMs becomes less. Now, what's the advantage of that? It leaves DISCOMs with more money, which they can use for their modernization, upgradation, and so on. All right. So that is one benefit. Second benefit is operational efficiency of DISCOMs has increased. Operational efficiency of DISCOMs has increased, like more electronic metering, better targeting of customers. All that has become better because under UDAY that is a part of scheme. So operational efficiency of DISCOMs has increased. And third benefit is that state governments have a stake in DISCOMs, which reduces incentives of populism. State governments have a stake in DISCOMs, which reduces incentive of populism. State governments have a stake in DISCOMs, which reduces incentive of populism. So, you know, when you look at this, generally speaking, this is where one has to be careful that when you talk about, now what is that populism? State chief ministers or state political leaders generally going for freebies that will give you electricity free of cost and all that. This can be reduced because state governments now hold a share in the DISCOM. So losses of DISCOM will reflect on their balance sheet. Also, and that is where the trouble is now coming in. In the last 3 years of UDAY's implementation, there is a problem we have seen. That even though state governments know that it is they who are at stake, still populism has not abated. You know, they're still going populist. Still promises which cannot be fulfilled are made. You know, at least cannot be fulfilled by right methods or by keeping fiscal deficit in control. You know, that but these promises are made openly. And transmission and distribution losses have been controlled, but have not been significantly controlled. These are the problems that we see in spite of UDAY. Transmission and distribution losses have come down by only 3% in the last 3 years. They were expected to be almost eliminated, you know. But 3 years have gone by now, and we still see major transmission and distribution losses, especially states like Bihar, states like Uttar Pradesh, states like now Tamil Nadu on a new front. We see heavy transmission and distribution losses emanating here, you know. And this is the worrying aspect in South India. South India had become an improved space. So the challenge was that you have to improve the northern part of Vindhyas, and we could make India the more on a more, you know, focused slot. But with death of some decent leaders around, and with rise of populism, we have seen South India going the North India way. You know, maybe it's that these days, you know, that is what is happening. But if you see Tamil Nadu is doing less, you know, better things than what it did just 5 years or 4 years back. So populism is becoming more, you know, important over there. Same applies on Karnataka. And this has to do, again, I repeat, this has to do with the politics of this space where the leadership part is missing. If you don't have leadership, you will have these issues. South India earlier used to have stronger leadership, you know, more popularity among people. People would vote en masse for a particular party, so that party knew that I am around. Nobody removes me for some time. All that said, that has started changing, and now you have a lot of flurry of things over there. Then the ambitions of some of the national parties, like say BJP, to create a space for themselves in South India, and then sometimes they think that it is only one way that they can create a space, and that is by polarization. So that creates issues at times, you know. So all that has resulted in, again, pulling populism back into picture. Otherwise, imagine, I was telling you this last class also, if Chandrababu Naidu ji says that we'll make a statue taller than any other statue in India. If I am from Andhra Pradesh, I repeat again, if there's someone from Andhra Pradesh, please do this. You know, I'll tell him that, sir, I'm not voting for you for your inconsistency. Because you see, Andhra Pradesh is poor enough to need special category status, and we need money from the central government to help the people. And on the other, you say we have enough money to make the tallest statue in the world. I mean, how do the two things add up? They don't add up, and don't do this. If you have enough money, like something like 3,000 crore or 4,000 crore to make the tallest statue in the world, use those 4,000 crore for development of the state. You know, so this is populism. This picks up. you know, that okay, I'll make something which is bigger than yours, and so on. This is what we need to cover about. Electricity sector is the biggest sufferer there, because somehow people are not trained in our country that they have to pay for electricity. See, we are trained that we have to pay for telephones. So even poors don't ask for any rebate on telephone. It's not that poors or lower middle class or just out of poverty line people are not using telephones in India, but they pay for telephones. You know, that is the point. Somewhere it is known that okay, if you don't pay, your telephone will stop working, and people then keep it not working till they have the money to put the telephone in working condition again. But when it comes to electricity, suddenly all of us are poor, including people like us, you know, who are not poor at all. So this is a cultural issue, that culturally we have been told or taught that electricity you can do without, and you can pay, you don't pay. Telephone, since right from the beginning it was the big man's thing and the rich man's thing, so even if rich men defaulted and they were not, and the telephone was disconnected, nobody sat on a dharna. Then they silently went, paid their bill so that nobody gets to know that my phone was disconnected due to lack of money being paid. This culture continues today even among poors. Then about electricity, right from the beginning populism worked. Government kept saying, now see, in the beginning it could work mainly because we did not give electricity to people. So in a state government election, you could come up and say, we will give you electricity free. But what will I give you free, which I will not give you finally? So we had villages which with hardly 1 hour of electricity in a day, half an hour of electricity, sometimes no electricity. You know, I've had an instance in my life where it was quite amusing to me. Younger days, I was a master's student in those days. So we had gone to Jabua district. It was with Dr. John Rees, and it was under a program for research on tribals and all. And we had gone over, so we were talking to a sarpanch. The seniors were talking, we were listening. And the sarpanch was a young fellow, 28, 29 years of age, 30 years of age. And this person, and children were, you know, there was an electric pole and wire hanging down, and children were swinging on that wire, you know. So one of them, us noticed it, and we warned the sarpanch. We said, stop them, if by chance there is electricity, they will die. And the sarpanch very confidently said, how can that happen? Even I have grown up swinging on this. Now this was long back, of course, 1995, 96, I'm telling you. But imagine a generation growing up where the pole is there and the wires are there, people swing across on that wire, confident that no electricity will come, you know. And then for 30 odd years it doesn't come. So in that scenario it was still fine, that no electricity, then you give it for free. But post 2003, we did reforms in electricity sector. We created a central electricity regulatory commission. And now you had electricity supply in India with some state governments taking the lead, like Bihar, Madhya Pradesh, Gujarat. These are states where rural electricity electrification and all began on a larger scale. And that now meant that free electricity meant actually free electricity. And that started burdening your discounts. So, you know, it's about structure not being created well. So in electricity sector, this is the issue we have had. Uday can be a solution, but Uday has to be implemented mostly focusing on making people disciplined, that they have to pay. Now government has introduced another program that is called Sahaj Bijli Har Ghar Yojana, Saubhagya. You know, this was introduced from September 2017. So this is another program in electrification of this is the country. This is Sahaj Bijli Har Ghar Yojana, Saubhagya as it is called. So Saubhagya was introduced from September 2017, and you take this September 2017 and you write this under Saubhagya, the objective is to electrify all households in the country full stop. Now government has estimated that there would be around 3 crore such households. Actually the estimate earlier was 4 crore. Then when they did a detailed research, they found that it is around 3.5 crore. Out of 3.5 crore households means family households. So out of 3.5, so that's around 17-18 crore people. So out of 3.5 crore households, 3.1 crore have applied for electrification under Saubhagya. So Saubhagya scheme goes like this, that government will ask people to apply for electrification through a door-to-door campaign. Like government officers, panchayat heads, panchayat officers, panchayat members, corporate of members, they will go door to door and they will take the or they'll ask the people to apply for electrification. Right? That is a door to door. So it's a supply side campaign. That government will supply electricity by asking people to demand for it. Right? That there will be a door to door campaign. Government officers will go, then there will be fairs organized so that people can come there and register themselves for electrification and so on. So this will be done by government using its techniques and then using the technology, that is Jandhan, Aadhaar and Mobile Trinity, Jam Trinity as we call it, to recognize people and then take their application for electrification. And then you take this, so you write, under Saubhagya, each household will be provisioned, under Saubhagya, each household will be provisioned with at least one DC fan, direct current, that is, based on lead-lithium battery. So one DC fan, comma, one DC plug charger, one DC fan, one DC plug charger, and one bulb socket with 5 LED bulbs free. One bulb socket with 5 LED bulbs free. And 5 years of free maintenance and repair. 5 years of free maintenance and repair. In areas which are not covered by thermal power, in areas which are not covered by thermal power, solar energy will be used. Areas which are not covered by thermal power, solar energy will be used. So this is the program, that each household should get a minimum of one bulb socket, one DC fan and one DC plug charger, and this will mean that, and then with 5 years of maintenance and repair free. So that will allow them to use electricity for a longer period of time. Now, after Saubhagya applications have been taken, till now, 3 crore 10 lakh households have applied for it. Till 30th November of this year, 1 crore 85 lakh households have already been covered under Saubhagya. And 1 crore 16 lakh are left over. The target is to cover all households by 31st December 2018. Alright, that is the target under Saubhagya. That all those households who have applied should be covered by 31st December 2018. Under this program, 31st December 2018. The target is to cover all by 31st December 2018. And then the target is that those who have not applied in the first round can be asked to apply again and then cover it up by 31st March 2019. So the target is that by 31st March 2019, every household in India should have electricity. All right, so those who have not applied in the first round, the target is to cover them in the second round by 31st March 2019. Now see, and the expenditure that government expects will happen on Saubhagya is 16,320 crore rupees. Out of which 12,000 crore has already been given through budget of 18-19. Expenditure expected is 16,320 crore rupees. 16,320 crore rupees. Out of which 12,000 crore has been given through the budget of 2018-19. And the rest is expected to be paid by the state governments